is the video? Could the video hit me and find this screen? Is the video okay? Okay, all right. So happy to be here this morning. Wow, this is a little bit loud. You should turn down this microphone or maybe the speakerphone slightly, a little bit. All right. Good to see each one of you. I think I saw you a couple weeks ago in the summer camp. Many of you came, and I hope you enjoyed, and I hope that you were blessed by it. And today is the Lord's Day. I pray that the Lord will bless us with the worship and with His Word. We have opened His Word, and we will now ask God to open our hearts. So how about let's bow our head and pray. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you. Today is your day. Father, I pray that today you will open our hearts and open our minds. And Father, I pray that you will bless each one of us. Anoint your unworthy servant so that he could preach your word with clarity and with power. Father, I pray that you will use your word, your Holy Spirit, to pierce our heart, change our minds. Father, we pray that before we leave this place, we will say that, Lord, it is good to be in your house. Our hearts are changed. Our lives are changed. Our soul, our minds are changed. We are different before we came into this house of the Lord. So Father, I pray that you will bless each one of us. Father, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I still hear some of that pitching sound. Is that the speaker or what? I still hear the sound. That is not good. Turn down the sound. Yeah, this is too, especially the treble. 把高音能不能调低一点? The treble. Yeah, if you could not turn down the treble, you turn down the volume. Okay. Could everybody hear me?
Yeah.
Yes? Okay. Those who could hear me, raise your hand. Okay. Those who cannot hear me, raise your hand. Well, if you could not hear, how could you raise your hand? All right. So today we come to this passage, Matthew 25. And this is the parable of the talents. Let's come and read these verses again, okay? Let's read it again. Last time you read so little sound, I want you to read it loudly, okay, and clearly. Now, Jesus said, "For he will be like a man going on a journey, who called his servants and entrusted to them his property. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his story. A nobleman. A nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and then return. So basically, I want you to know that when Jesus was saying this parable, this is a parallel parable. You could read either from Matthew or from Luke, and there are many, many similarities interwoven with one another. So you want to understand the big picture, you read Matthew and also you read Luke. But we don't have time to read Luke. So I'll just give you some background, okay? So that's why I'm here to Luke. So this is from Luke, okay? So Jesus was saying that there is a nobleman. He went into a far, 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 far country to receive for himself a kingdom and then return. Then I will explain to you the background, let you know. Then this is the story. He called his servants and entrusted them his property. Okay, we come back to Matthew. And to one he gave 5 talents. To another 2, to another 1, each according to his ability, and he went away. So, you know, the one who received 5, he went at once and traded with that money, and then made 5 talents more. So, it's the same who had the 2 talents also made 2 talents more. But the one who had received the 1 talent went and dug in the ground and hid his money, not his master's money. Now, after a long time, the master of those servants came and settled accounts with them. So you see, master, here I have 5 more. 5 plus 5. Well done. You see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. And here, who has 2? Here, 2 plus 2. Well done. Good and faithful servant. Hey, this one time. Master, I give you to be a hard man. What? What are you talking about? You're a harsh man. So I was afraid and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Okay. Here, this was yours. 1. Where's 1 plus 1? No, just 1. You wicked and slothful servant. Now, take the talent from him and give it to him who has the 10 and has this worthless servant into the outer darkness. Then he was taken away and this 1 more. So, in that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. That's what Jesus said. So this is the parable. Now let's come to the background of this story. So basically, when you came to the Roman history, the Roman Empire was a big empire, a powerful empire. So when you read the history of the Roman Empire, it's very, very long, 1,000 years. And the political system and the government system changes over time. And especially at Jesus' time, anxious and you, when you don't have food, you have a problem, right? And when you have too much food, they don't have freezer or refrigerator at that time. When you have too much food, what? They are rotten, they are spoiled. So if you could manage the food in a city very well, then you are a good person. You are a knowledgeable and you know you're a capable person. Then you could be promoted to someone who could manage the money and promoted to someone who could manage even the military power or the police. You could be promoted. And then eventually you could become the mayor of this city. Wow, when you become a mayor, you are the biggest one, the biggest person. And in Jesus' time, Jesus called that person as a nobleman. He has a big family, he is well educated, he has his people's network, he managed things well, and he is well respected in the city, in the Roman Empire. But now, after you become a mayor, you say, I don't want to be a mayor of, you know, this little small town Judea. I want to become the governor of Pennsylvania, okay? I want to become governor of this entire province. What do? You run the election? No. You go to fight? No. There's no way. How do you get promoted to become the governor of the entire province? There's one way. That one way is very difficult. That one way is what Jesus said here in the parable. Now, you are the mayor of the city. Give up everything you have. What? Give up everything I have? Yes. Give up everything you have. Leave it to your household, to your servant. And now, come to Rome, the capital city of Roman Empire. Come to Rome and join the Senate. You become the senator. Here in the senator, in the Senate, you become a senator. And senator, you have no control of your household, of your city, of your province. No. You came from here, you gave up everything. And for 1 year, 2 years, 3, 5, we don't know. For a certain period of time, then the Roman emperor, the emperor, Caesar will examine you. Well, let me see. Are you faithful to me? Are you good? Are you capable? Are you going to go back to your country, rally up the military, and rebel against me, and the revolution? Well, I will keep you here for a year or two or three or five. We don't know. But the Caesar will decide. The emperor will decide. And after quite a while, maybe some of the senators may enjoy the life in Rome. You see, in Rome, you have the theaters. You have the gladiators, the Colosseums. You have the horse racing court. The horse, you see, you have the public place. Or you have the perfume. You have all those money and fame luxuries. You have all those goods, those important goods coming from all over the country. You get the best pearl, the best jewel, the best diamond, the best gold. You get all those best things here in Rome. So being a senator, some of them, they say, you know, we want this life, this city life, this prosperity, this good life. I'm not going back to this small city, small town, small province. I will stay here forever. So many noblemen, after they were moved from their own country to the city, to a far, far, far land, they never returned. Some of them, of course, they returned later. We don't know, 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, or even longer. It depends on the emperor. So after this while, when the emperor examined this person, and he decided that, now I think you are qualified. You are faithful to me. I know you are powerful. I know you are capable. I know you are good. And I know that you are loyal to me. If I send you back to your country, to your province, you are not going to lead a rebellion against me. So I am happy and I am confident. Now I the Roman titles, if you see the proconsul, the proedit, the pro something, the prefect, the pre, all those things means the governor or means those who have the military power. So, Jesus' story, the background is like that. He said that, you know, here's a nobleman. He was sent away to a foreign country, and we don't know if he's returning or not, but for quite a while, and before he left, he gave his money and he put his talents into his servant's hand and said, use it, and then I'm going away. Someday I'll come back. Well, maybe not. So that's the story. You get a background? Okay, those who get a background, raise your hand. Okay. What? You did not get a background? So you get what I say? No? Yes? Okay, good. You're sitting so comfortable, you don't want to raise your hand. Come on. All right, now, this is the Roman Empire. The official name of the Roman Empire is SEQR, which is the segregation of Fanatus, Apolusque, Romanus. Okay, some of you will say hard to be that, right? The Roman Senate and people. So, Roman Empire basically is the composition of the people and the Senate. So here's the Senate, and these are the people. And in Roman Empire, here I have to give you a background, and you have to open your eyes, and you have to open your ears, you have to hear what this means. Now, come to the economy situation here. Back to Jesus' time, let's come to the economical background. We want to know the currency used at Jesus' time. Okay, and we want to see how many workdays at this time they come here to the USA today. Now, come. First of all, one talent. Talent is the Greek word talentos. The plural form is talentoi. Okay, it is not talent like a gift of piano and a gift of singing. No. Talent, talentos, is a Greek word. It is a unit. It's like a money, or it's a unit. Talking about money. So one talentos is 60 minas. Okay, 60 mina. One mina is 100 drachmas or denarii. And one drachma is one day wage. All right, you get the math? Okay, do the math. All right. So one talent is 6,000 daily wages. Wow, 6,000 daily wages. How many years? Do the math. If you hear my sermon, you gotta do the math. I do the math for you. Okay. Typical Israelites, they work 6 days a week, 45 days a year. So one talent is 6,000 daily wages. That's about 20 years of wage. Okay? So that's the money. You get the number? Now, come to the third one. Compared to the United States today, the GDP per capita 2021, okay, that's the last year, okay, that's 69,288, okay, I got this number from the government. I just got the government, okay? Otherwise, this will be the precise number. So, for the number today, or 2021, a couple months ago, one talent is about $1.45 million. Two talent is $3.08 million in today's money. And five talent is $7.7 million. Okay, that's last year. That's not this year. This year we got some inflation, right? So the number would be a little bit higher than this. So now tell me, is that noble man a generous or a stinky man?
Generous.
I'll just give you one talent. $1.5 million. Don't tell me it's too little. Oh, come on. $1.5 million. Just give it to me. That's good for the rest of my life. Maybe two lives, three lives. Well, man. So, that is a very generous nobleman. So, we got the background. This is a very generous nobleman, and he gave this money to his servants. But basically, you have to understand, these are the master's money. This is not for you, okay? This is just give it to you. Because here in the story, you see that the servants got the money. He did not say, this is your salary. This is your petty cash. This is your pocket money. This is your bonus. No, money, many, many good number of monies. So that's what the master gave. And now, he gave to them, and we now come to the good and the evil servants. Now, so the good servants, he who received the 5 talents went at once. Wow, quickly. Went at once, very quickly. And traded with them, and he made 5 talents more. So also he who had the 2 talents went and made 2 talents more. Okay, here's the one word, the trade. Trade, this Greek word does not necessarily mean doing business. It just means you use the money to do something. Of course, if you want to do business, you use this money and then you buy something. When you buy something, you sell it. You sell it at a profit, right? And you sell it at a higher price. Suppose you get, let's say, 10% higher, you get the profit 10%, then if you have $100, then you buy $100 good, that is your cost, and you sell it for $110, you receive $10 more, 10% more, and you use this $110, you buy more things, and you sell it at $121, you get 10% more. You use $121 and buy things, and then you sell it at $133. You get 10% more. So doing the business once, twice, 3 times, maybe after 7 times, you got $195. You double it. So this is a hard work, because if I buy something $100, I want to sell it at $200. Nobody's going to buy it from me. But if I do it little by little, gradually, time after time, I build up my reputation, then people will start doing business with me, and I could do bigger and bigger business. So you see that the person who received 5 and also the person who received 2 talentos, they do business. They did it in the hard way, I'll put it this way. They did this hard work. So the master would say, you know, well done, good and faithful servant. I entrusted you this money, you do business, and you did it well. Yeah, I'm sure you perspirate, you know, it's a hard work. You shed your tears, you labor it. I'm sure you did it well, very good, very good. So these are the good servants, right? The good servants. Now, so we see that they received these talent. One received about $3 million. The other will receive about $7.7 or $8 million. And the Bible says that the master gave them each according to his, according to his ability. And yeah, give this person to feel, well, it's not good enough. I know he's capable. I know he can handle a large business. So each one according to the business, according to his ability. That's how the master did. And what the 2-3 people did here. So for the one who had 2, the one who had 5, they began to work. And the Bible says that they do it immediately. That means they are active. They are anxious. They are excited. They say, wow, the Lord, the master gave me this much opportunity. I'm going to use this money to invest. I'm going to use this opportunity. I'm going to do this job. I don't know when he will return. I don't know. Maybe he's not going to return. I don't know, but this is the master's money. I want to use this. Then they, these two, they went and they did business and they did it well. So that's pretty good. Now, come to this one. But he who had received the 1 talent went and dug in the ground and did his master's money. That is bad. Why did he say that? Why did he do that? New City Catechism. Servant, what was his problem? His problem is that, hey, master, this is not fair. I don't like it. I know you are a hard man, a harsh man, a tough man. I don't like you. Wherever you don't sow and you want us to reap, whatever you did not scatter, you want us to correct. You are a bad master. I don't like you. You give me only one talent. You gave me only $1.5 million. That's too little, right? Do we complain that? Lord, that's too little. This money is too little, 1.5 million. How many of you think 1.5 is too little? 1.5 million, no. But this guy, he said that's too little. That's worthless. That's not enough to start the business. That's no good. He been complaining. You? Did you ever grumble or complain about God, about your parents? Hey, daddy, mommy, you know, why could he have that iPad? Why could she have that much pocket money? Why could they live in such a big house? Why could they have that beautiful car? Why do they have the wonderful computer, the keyboard, shiny one? Why don't I have this? Well, be careful. Many times when we complain, we are comparing ourselves to others, those who seem to are better, well off. But we rarely compare with those people on the street. They don't have house. They don't have parents. They don't have schools. They don't have education. They don't have medical assistance. They don't have job. They don't have friends. They are diseased. There are many people in the world like that. Some people here in Philadelphia, some people in Africa, some people in China, some people even in Europe. They are homeless people. And we normally, we don't consider them. We consider those rich people, oh, Bill Gates, oh, Warren Buffett, those people live next to me. Whoa, they are rich, they are famous. Whoa, they could have this, they could have that. Oh, look at them. But the 10th commandment warns us and requires us be content because God knows us. God knows how much in our hand. I have this kind of health. I have this kind of build-up. I have this body. I have this strength. I have this brain. I have this talent, this gift. I could do this. I could do that. Many people could do music beautifully. Well, I could not. Many people can write literature beautifully. Many people can draw pictures or comics nicely. Well, I cannot. But that's all right. I have what God entrusted to me. And each one of you also. God gives you different talents. God gives you different specialties that other people don't have. God knows you. God knows each one of us. And in his wisdom and in his sovereignty, he decides what to give and what to withhold from us. So God decided, because he is all knowledgeable and he is all powerful, he decided. We are not to complain. We are to use whatever God gave it to me here in my hand. I'm going to use this for God's glory, because this is God's talent. This is God's money. Okay? person, and he used that as an excuse to not working on the master's money. Now, come to the end of the story, verses 19 to 30. Now, let's see the guaranteed rewards. If you work hard, you will get reward. Now, after a long time, well, this is really a long time, just speaking in the background, a long time, because the Roman Empire could be 2 years, could be 3 years, 5 years, 7 years, or 7 years, you forget it. So after a long time, the master of those servants came and said, "Well, come to them." Well, that day will come. Jesus said that, you know, I'm ascended to heaven, as we read from the Apostles' Creed. Jesus ascended heaven, and he put in our hands our church, our family, our talents, everything, and Jesus guaranteed he will return. He will. We don't know when. After a long time, I don't know, 10 years, 100 years, but he will return. He's not going to stay here in the sand and then enjoy the prosperity life. No. When he was crowned, and he will come back to us, and he will be the governor, not only a small city, he will be the governor of the entire province, the entire land. So, after a long time, this master came back. And who received 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 talents more, saying, "Master, you delivered to me 5 talents. Here, I have 5 talents more." His master said to him, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little." Wow, that's a little, right? $7 million is a little, right? It's not much. "I will send you over much. Enter into the joy of your master." So same with this 1.85. Plus 5. Well done. Now, another one. The one who had 2 also do the same thing. And the master say, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little." You know, $3 million is really not much. Right? Just over a little. Good. Faithful. Good. "I will send you over much. Enter into the joy of your master." Well, well done, well done. Now, notice the background. In Jesus' time, there is a clear distinction, a clear line between a master and a servant. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 11, Jesus says that when the master and also the servant, they've been working so hard. Maybe the master was going out and then meeting people, doing business. And when he came home, he was so tired, so weary, and so thirsty and hungry. And also the servant. The servants have been working in the field and then scattering the seed or maybe collecting, harvesting the crop. And then the servant has been very tired, weary as well. And in Luke chapter 11, tells us that when the master, when the servant both came home, they are all tired and weary. So the master, what did he say? He said, "Whoa, man, you work so hard. Well, let me serve you." No, the master sit down and say, "Come, serve me. Serve me. You are a servant. I'm a master. You are tired. Me too. Even you are not tired, you are tired, that doesn't matter. You are a servant. Serve me. So put on your belt. Put on your towel. Grab the food. Get a drink. Come, set the table. Do this." And the servants, even being very tired, very weary, then he came and served everything the master requires him. And after the servants served the master, he said, "Master, there is nothing you should commend me. I've done what I am required to do. That's my job. Being a servant, this is what I do. You, being a master, you have your business. You do your business. I'm a servant. I do my business." So in Jesus' time, the master and the servant, they have a clear line. The servants don't join the master. The master don't join the servants. They are totally separated, except by serving. But in Jesus' parable here, he says that, "Come, come, enter into the joy of your master." What does this mean? In the language-wise, come, join the master. You are no longer a servant. You are now the master's friend. servant. You could come and you could enjoy the master's joy. And now come to the bad one. He said to the one who received one talent, the one came and said, "Master, I know you be a hard man. Reaping where you do not sow, and gather where you scatter not seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you have one yours." Yeah. The master is not happy. "Hey, you are a tough guy. You are rough and tough, hard and harsh. Right, I don't like you." That's many of us. We don't like God. Do we like God? "God, why am I suffering like this? Why am I being bullied? Why don't I have a lot of money? Why am I not like, you know, those people? Why, you know, you are hard. You are tough. You are rough. You are hard and harsh. I don't like you, God." Well, many times we complain to God, and that's bad. And the master says, "What? $1.4 million? $1.5 million? Is that too little? Man, what are you talking about? I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. So you have nothing to do with me. I have nothing to do with you. I did not steal from you. I did not do bad things to you. Master, basically, you do whatever you do. I do whatever I do. I don't care about your interest to me. I'm a lazy person, basically." So the master said to him, "You wicked and slothful person." Wow, wicked and slothful. What? Why would he say that? Why is that wicked? And why is he considered slothful? So basically, this person is wicked. He's no good. When people entrust you something, you don't want to do things for the master's glory. You don't want to do things for the master's. And you were considering that the master, he goes to Rome and he would never return. Well, you are very presumptuous. You are so self-righteous. You are so presumptuous. And you are so wicked. I tell you, I will return. And I give you this money, $1.54 million. I give this to you. I trusted you. I entrust this to you. And you are lazy. And you're blaming me being unkind, being rough and tough, harsh and hard. You, but actually you're slothful. You're doing nothing for me. That is very bad. A very bad condemnation. So his excuse became his own condemnation. The Lord will say that if this is what you say and you still disobey me, this is what you will receive. You think you know better? You think you know what is better for you? You don't think $1.5 million is good enough? You know better. Well, then, here is what's going on. This is the passage that we don't like. We don't enjoy. How many of us will think about the judgment day of Christ? When Christ comes, he will judge us. And the one who even what you think, what you have, will be taken away. That is a hard saying. But that is a saying from Jesus. Jesus is warning us. My friend, I've been giving you this opportunity. I've been giving you according to my knowledge, my omnipotence, according to my privilege, my right, my decision. I'm giving you all this. Go, do your job. And do not complain. Do not compare with others, because I will come and judge you. Don't find excuses. Look at those people, how much they work, how hard they work, how long they work for God's glory. And you put my money away and just live your life as I do not exist. That's how you do? Hello, mister. Hello, servant. Don't you forget you are a servant? Don't you remember? You took all this and hid it? Pretending that the master do not exist? Is that how you do it? So Jesus gave this solemn warning to the people to say, don't be like that. And at that time, when the judgment comes, now look at this. Cast the worthless servant into the outer darkness. Here you say that when the master returns, he is no longer a local mayor or a local governor. When the county, it is out from your kingdom. That's away from the kingdom. And there will be darkness, will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. I hope this will be sobering to everyone of us. This is true. And Jesus says this because he guarantees those who work hard for the Lord, you will receive your reward. And those who refuse to work for God, you will also receive your reward. A couple weeks ago, I had a friend, we were using our WeChat on a cell phone, and a pastor was saying that, we had an evangelism campaign and invite friends into the church and come to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. If you come, confess your sin, repent from your guilt, and some of my friends sadly would say that, Pastor, I'm just getting so busy and I'm not interested in this evangelical campaign. I'm not interested in the gospel. I'm not interested actually in the heaven because, I was a Christian. I am a Christian. I've been a Christian for all my life. I don't need this message. And basically, I don't need the kingdom of heaven of people playing harp on the cloud in the sky. Come on. We don't want that. We don't need that. I have so much things to do in my life. So some friends, actually my friends, will actually say that on the WeChat. On the cell phone, say that. And the pastor just answered them. It's not me. Another pastor who is older than I am. The pastor just said that, saying, well, for those who care not about God, you don't have to care about God. Because in eternity, you will not see God. God will put you to the place where you belong to. And you don't have to go to heaven. Because if you go to heaven, you will see God every day, every minute. Whoa, that would be a curse to you. So if you don't like God, if you don't love God, you don't have to go to heaven. Well, I think my pastor, he's a strong man. He's a very well-educated man, very powerful man. And he spoke the truth. So, let's come to the conclusion. The normal man has a different position now. He's no longer a local governor, the governor, global king. Okay? The good and faithful servants are no longer servants, but all rulers and friends with the king. So when the king is crowned, and he called his servants, and for the faithful servant, he gave them 10 cities. Five cities. safe. We thought we are okay. But Jesus Christ will come and judge us. Conclusion, God is generous. Each person receives differently. You and I were different. I'm not as good as you are in certain ways, and you are not as good as I am in certain ways. You're different. Your value was different. Yet, even the least one received a lot. Even the smallest one, the smallest servant, you received 1.5 million dollars. That's a lot. And genuine liberties are given. You have this freedom, liberty. Use your time, use your money, use your talent, your gift. Use whatever you have. You are good in math, you are good in science, in history, in geography, in literature, in fine arts, in cooking, baking, in gardening. Whatever you do, use it, liberty. So everyone is free to apply the Lord's entrustment to trade or to do business, to go to bank or do anything, to produce more food for God. You have your liberty. Okay? Sir, guaranteed reward. Good and faithful workers will be received to God's happiness. And wicked and lazy workers will be rejected by God into his wrath and darkness. So that's the message today, and I'll give you a challenge. If you will listen, I'll come back here after 3 weeks and 4 weeks. I'll give you a homework. I'll give you a homework, 4 weeks, 28 days. All right, listen, 28 days, write diary, journal. Okay, what do you write? First, count your blessing. Today is Sunday, okay, August 28th. I thank God because I'm healthy. Consider my friends there. He's been sick all the time. Consider this and that. Okay, so whatever you do, first, count your blessing every day, okay? I'll give you big reward after 28 days. I'll come here on September 25th, right? September 25th, I'll be here, yeah, okay. So, first, write your blessings. Count your blessings. Second, I want you, every one of you, young or old, okay, either you are 8 years old or 18 years old, okay, young or old, everyone, every day, at least once, proactively ask your parents, Daddy, Mommy, is there anything I can do for you? Anything I can help you? Proactively. Don't let your parents say, hey, come, kids, come on, help me. No, that doesn't count. You have to be proactively asking your daddy, mommy, if there's anything you could do for them, okay? That's the second thing. Every day, you have to do that for 28 days, okay? I guarantee I'll bring you big prize after 28 days. Okay. And thirdly, well, this will be hard for someone, but will be okay and easy for someone. Thirdly, do not play video games or computer games for 28 days.
No.
Okay. You want to? You want to use your time helping your daddy, your mommy, your brother, your sister, your classmate, your friends. You want to use your time, your energy to help others. So, this is a challenge to you. I don't want you to waste your time. Well, you could play that after 28 days, okay? So this is, well, for someone, you just don't have a computer. For someone, just don't play a game, right? Here you could trust me. All right. May I have your attention? May I have your attention, please? For the parable that Jesus was saying, he was giving the people a very honest and urgent warning. He does not want his servant wasted time. He does not want his servants wasting their energy. He wants his servant to do the right thing. He wants his servant to persevere. He wants his servant to help each other out. You look at that wicked servant. He was thinking that, you know, that person received 5 talents. This person received 2 talents. We are together. We are the same. We are the servants. We are in the same family. But at the judgment day, he will find that his false security disappeared. That is very sad. And that's why Pastor Douglas here is giving you just a very, very small test, 28 days. Come on. If you live up to 80 years, 28 days is really nothing. It's less than 1%. If you don't want to do it, you don't have to do it. But for those who will do it and keep a record, now listen, I'll give you this promise now. For those who keep the record, your daily journal, you write down your daily gratitude, you count your blessing every day, and you ask your daddy, mommy, what you could do for the family, for your sister, your brother, for your daddy, mommy. You write this down, and what your daddy, mommy tells you, you do this, and you write third one, okay, I do not play computer game this day. If you do that 28 days, Pastor Douglas will come here after 28 days. I'll give you a price no less than $50. I promise you that. So keep your record and let us pray. Let's bow our head. Let us pray, okay? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you. This is a sobering parable. We know there is a judgment coming in. We want to be faithful, good. We want to be faithful, good and servant. We want to be good and faithful servant. We want to be wise servant. We want to be a servant living for your glory, not for our own comfort, not for our own laziness. Father, there are so many people living in poverty, in hunger, in discomfort, in persecution in this world. Our parents have been working so hard to raise the family, to support us for school, for the things we buy. Father, I pray that you will give us, each one of us, a grateful heart. We will be thankful to you and to our parents that have been working so hard for our benefit. We want to be proactively asking our parents what we could do for them and for your glory. You give us time, you give us strength, give us health, give us energy, give us many, many good things. Father, all these are good. All these are good in you. Father, I pray that solemnly and seriously, Lord, let none of us live in false security. Let us, not each one of us will live in false security, thinking that judgment will not come, because you guarantee us that judgment will come. And we better learn this while we are still young. So Father, bless us, encourage us, keep us, so we will love you more, experience you more, and you will bless us, bless our family, bless our brothers and sisters, bless our church, bless our city, bless our country. Father, I thank you, and I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.